Father, we thank thee for the great privilege that we have to come to thee. First, we cannot come except by Christ. So therefore we place his name ahead of our prayer. And then we know by his word that you will answer us, for we ask in his name. No righteousness of our own, nothing that we possess that we can do. But by grace alone we come, asking in Christ's name. Father, there may be many men and women in here around this building tonight who are sinners. Thou to die for this sinner, may this be the night that God will speak to their heart and call them by his grace into the kingdom. Grant it, Father, maybe they've wasted a many year wandering around in sin, but may this be the hour. Thank you, Lord, for Billy Paul tonight. My poor little motherless boy, tossed about. Thank you, Lord, for giving the Holy Spirit as assurance now. Some glorious day we'll see Mommy again. All things will be all right. Oh, God, let the angels let her know today. She cried so in her death that serve God. Someday Billy Paul would be a man and receive the Holy Ghost. Amen. Prayers are answered. God bless the boy now. Amen. May he follow along to the footsteps of the Master. How his little boy just trembling when he said, Daddy, I just received the Holy Ghost. I'm so happy. God, may that be the experience of ever unborn again person here tonight. May they receive the Holy Ghost tonight. We do that in sin, forgive us, Lord. Heal the sick, bind up the broken heart. And now, Lord, I don't even know where to start to speak tonight, but thou wilt provide. I believe thee, and I ask that you'll give us something that would help the people while we ask it in his name. Amen. Just for a little scripture reading here, in Isaiah 35, I wish to read, because my words will fail. God's word will never fail. Therefore, no service is complete without first the reading of the Scripture. The wilderness, the solitary places, shall be glad for them, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as a rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice even in the joy, saying, and glorious shall come to Lebanon. Shall give unto it the essence of Carmel and Sharon. They shall see the glory of the Lord and the excellency of our God. Strengthen ye the weak hand and confirm the feeble knees. Say unto them that are a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with recompense. He will come and save you. He will open the ears of the deaf, shall be unstopped. Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb shall sing. For in the wilderness shall the waters break out, the streams in the desert. And the parched ground shall become a pool, and a thirsty land, springs of water. The habitation of dragons where each lake shall be grass and reeds and rushes, and a highway shall be there, and a way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over, but it shall be for those the wayfaring man, though fools shall not. not err therein. No lion shall be there, nor any grievous beast shall go thereon. It shall not be found there, but the redeemed shall walk therein. And the ransom of the Lord shall return and come to Zion with songs and everlasting joy upon their heads. They shall obtain joy and gladness, and sorrow and sighing shall flee away. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his word. I want to speak tonight, if God willing, just a few moments to you. I watch my watcher that I don't keep you too long tonight. After through the services of this week trying to show people that there's no need of being scared, the worst thing the devil can put up on you is fear. If you even had a cancer and didn't fear and believe God would heal you, you wouldn't be in too bad a shape. God take care of that. If you were sick, whatever it is, if you didn't fear. So fear is one of the worst things that Satan can place up on the person. Now, this week I have tried to prove by the scripture that the man that's born again of the kingdom of God has nothing to fear. You're absolutely safely secure in Jesus Christ. All the Father has given me, he said, will come to me. No man can come unless the Father calls. The Father's got to lead him up to me, and he that comes to me, I will in no wise cast out. And all, no man can pluck him out of my Father's hand. No man's greater than he is. He that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, shall not come into condemnation, but pass from life, from death unto life. He that eats my flesh and drinks my blood hath, not will have, but hath present tense, everlasting life, and I'll raise him up at the last day. Wherefore, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed until the day of your redemption. There you are. Sealed the way until the day of your redemption. Not just from one revival to another, but till the day of your redemption. May now the Holy Ghost come in this morning and bless us on that. Tepeshir 1:30 this morning from about 9:30. How he blessed us. Now tonight, I want to speak on Isaiah said here, there shall be a highway and a way of holiness. Now I want to speak on God's way. God's way that's been made for us. Now, if I was going to New York City, the best thing for me to do is not try to find geographically how I'm situated and take off north, but the best way to do is get a map and follow the map. Is that right? A highway. If I don't, I get in trouble. There's no shortcuts in God's kingdom. You know, we try to make a shortcut, we get out here in a pond somewhere and mire down. And that's what we do when we get off the grand old highway of God.
Amen.
God's made a path, a way. When the children of Israel come out of the land of Egypt, they followed God's path. It led up to the Red Sea. It's strange that God would lead his path up that way, but his path went right through the sea. So when it comes time in the showdown, and Israel stood there before the sea, God's path led across the sea, so God looked down through the pillar of fire. The sea got scared, moved back, and Israel went across on dry land.
Amen.
God's path led through it. Then he went right up to the wilderness, into the spring of Myra, bitter water. Isn't it strange that God would lead his children through bitter waters? But them all goes along the road. But when he was there, the remedy for the bitter waters was standing on the bank. Moses cut out a tree and throw it in the water and turned sweet again. Some through the water, some through the flood, some through deep trials, but all through the blood. That's the way God leads his children. God's path, God's provided way. If the children of Israel would have to try to bypass and go around down this way, they'd have gotten in trouble. They had to follow the cloud of fire, the pillar of fire that led them. They followed that. And if the church tonight will only follow of the pillar of fire, the Holy Spirit, you'll make Canaan as sure as anything. God has a way, a provided way. There's two ways a man can go. And that's his way or God's way. And that's the right way or the wrong way. And your way is always the wrong way, and God's way is the right way. And you can't be in your own way and in God's way at the same time, so you got to get out of your own way so God can have His way in you. That's right. God makes a provided way. Man has always wanted to make his own way. In the Garden of Eden, God made a man so he didn't have to shift for nothing. God made him perfect. But man wanted his own way. He wanted to hamper. He wanted to find out. And then as soon as he fell, we went through that this week in the studies of the Scripture, he made himself a religion. He didn't wait for God to make him one. He made one himself. But he found out that his religion, his covering, wouldn't work. That's always been man. He wants his own way. But God had a way. So man made fig leaves and put them over him and his wife. But when he come down to face God, he found out that wouldn't work. And I'll tell you, friends, there's been many a man in this tonight that's coming down to the end of the road to find out that that little shallow religion that you're holding on to won't work.
Amen.
Nothing short of being born again will work. Jesus said, except a man be born of water and spirit, he will in no wise enter into the kingdom. No wise. No matter if he's Methodist, Baptist, Presbyterian, whatever he is, he'll not enter in until he's born of water and spirit. Born means he's changed. He has to die before he can be born. So you got to die to yourself, be reborn again in Christ Jesus. That's right. Now, I want you to notice, he found himself trying to make his way. We have this morning how Cain tried to make his way. He brought down some apples and pears and peaches and pumpkins or what it was, laid it up on the altar and said, now there, Lord, I build an altar. I build a church. I'm a good church member. See? I go to church every day. I come here and build the altar. I put the sacrifice up on it. Now I'm going to kneel down and pray. And now, Lord, I want you to receive me. But God refused him. And that same old religious spirit lives right down amongst the church today, the very same thing, just as religious as they can be, and knows more about God than a Hottentot would know about Egyptian knife. You know that's the truth. Religious spirit. Don't think that stalling is the Antichrist. The Bible says the two spirits will be so close together to see the very elect if possible.
Amen.
We find out that Judas Iscariot come right down and went out and rejoiced and preached the gospel, come back hollering and shouting and having a big time with the rest of the disciples. St. Matthew, the 10th chapter. But he followed the disciples right along, yet the incarnated devil. And come right along as Jesus was the incarnated God, the Cain and the Abel from the Garden of Eden. But when it comes time for him to go up to Pentecost and get the blessing, he showed his colors. And when you go talking about being born again, receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost, 9 times out of every 10, them spirits will show their colors what they are. You say that's a bunch of fanaticism. Leave it away. Brother, it's God's provided way for man today. Hallelujah! Look! God has always made a provided way. God's under obligation to make a way. God makes a way for nature. Why do we have these big floods through the country? You cut off all the timbers and things like that. But they're washed down. You build up a dam down here, fills up the riverbed. There she goes. The water, you interfere with nature. God had a provided way. That's what causes the flood. Anything that man tampers into that God has made perfect, then you imperfect it. Right. Now, just like, for instance, like the ducks. I actually watch the ducks seasons when I go hunting up in the mountains. I'd be up there in the fall of the year. Well, there the ducks all come out of Louisiana down there, down the swamp, go up north, and they settle down, make a nest, and raise their little ducklings. Then their little fellows raise up. Maybe come along about September this time of year, late September. And then the little duck, little drake, he's never been off that pond. He's just right there in a pond. After a while, the frost flies up down the mountain. A little snow hits up there, and a cold breeze blows down across that mountain. That little old duck feels that. Now, he's been no word on that pond. He ain't a year old yet. He sticks his head up in the air, a little honker. Run out in the middle of the pond, go honk honk. Every duck on the pond will come to him. Every duck on the pond knows that he's a barn leader. And that little old duck will rise off that pond without a compass or anything else and go just as straight to Louisiana through the rice fields as he can go. Looks like Christians ought to have duck sense anyhow, doesn't it?
Right.
Why? You say it's instinct. No, they go God's provided way. God give them a way, an instinct to lead them down there, and they believe it.
Amen.
But God give man the Holy Ghost, and he rejects it. He wants his own way, but God has a provided way for him. Hallelujah. I feel kind of religious tonight after listening to a few nights of revival. Notice, there it is, yes, sir. That little duck will go down there, and I'll tell you something else. You go out here to the newspaper, say, tomorrow, it's going to be pretty weather. And you go hunting and watch them rabbits go to settling down in that grass. Don't you better read that newspaper. You watch that old sow take the shucks off of the north side of the hill and take them over here on the south side of the hill and make her a bed over on the south side of the hill. She knows more about it than all the newspaper commentators in the world. Right? Got an instinct. She's getting around on the south side to hide that cold north wind coming down. Oh my! If a hawk's got sense enough to hide from the breeze, what about you and the Holy Ghost?
Yeah.
Hallelujah! That's your instinct. Yes, sir. It's God give them an instinct. It's God's provided way for them. They live in God's provided way. You take a fire, when he dies, he goes down the ground. Not the end of him, he lives again. God made a provided way for him. And he believes in it. God always has made a provided way. Sometimes it don't lead to pleasant things. Sometimes it goes to the hardship. But it's God's provided way. God makes it anyhow. One time he had a man in God's provided way. He had to go into a lion's den. But he went God's provided way. God brought him back out again. Hallelujah. I should see some Hebrew children sitting down there babbling one morning. They refused to bow to an idol. That's right. They said, we won't do it. Beat all the music you want to and sound your cornets and trumpets, but we'll not bow down to your idol. Hallelujah. Give us some more Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yes, sir. Let's bow down to your worldly stuff. We don't have to knock down to it. God's made us free by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Now I can see down there one morning. Let's turn our cameras down that way a minute and watch and see. I can see them boys down there one morning. They said, now look, the king said, everybody don't bow down. We're going to throw him in the fire furnace. And they went and prayed through one night. The next day when the sound come, they said, bow before the image while they turned their back to it. So he come out and said, boys, did you do that? Yeah, well, we heat the furnace up 7 times hotter than it ever was. Now, isn't that strange? There was a gangplank laying out here going up to the mouth of the furnace. All over Babylon was red that morning, the fire roaring. I see King Nebuchadnezzar as a modern man today sit out there and said, now we'll just burn all that Holy Ghost religion out of them guys. Oh, yeah, don't you think the devil won't burn you? He sure will. But remember, the Holy Ghost is fire itself. Now, I want you to watch. God's way led right up that gangplank. I can see Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walk in the death march. I can hear Shadrach say, Abednego, did you pray through? Yeah. All right. Are you sure you're God's way? Yes, sir. God said in his word for us not to bow to idols, and we won't do it. God is able to deliver us from this fire furnace, but if you don't, what of it? We're not going to bow down. We're going to God's provided way.
Amen.
I hear somebody say, are you sure you got his provided way? Yes! Hallelujah. Some say, well, don't you think all them people possible could be right instead of you? No, sir. The Bible said so. And we're staying with it. Right up that gangplank they go. He gets so intense, he was almost, he didn't kill the man that brought him up. They're just about ready to step in. God hasn't said a word. They're still walking the provided way. Walked right up to the mouth of the furnace. Just about time they got ready to step into the fiery furnace. You know, I got an awful bright picture here in front of me just now. Man that tries to live true to God, walking God's provided way, fixing to be burned up. goes on. I can see him sitting there and his priestly robes around him. Hallelujah. I can see the first thing coming from the right, a great big angel called Michael. They got one up there. Do you know that? I hear him run up there on the other side and say, Master! I see him take his sword out of his shield like this and say, have you looked down at Babylon this morning? There's man walking God's provided way. There's man who's willing to seal their testimony this morning. Our brother is just about to be burned. I hear him say, let me go down there. I'll change the picture. I believe he could have done it. I do. I hear him say, no. Can't let you do it, Gabriel. You've been a Michael. You've been a very fine angel. So put your sword back. Stand attention there. Here comes another angel. He's called Wormwood. He makes the waters bitter. Here he comes up and, Master, look down there. I've got all the control of the waters. You turn it over to me in the antediluvian destruction, and I've washed the whole world away, all but Noah and his people. Now, he said, let me go down there, and I'll wash Babylon off the map. I hear him say, what more you can do it? That's right, but I can't let you go. It's a man-sized job. Oh, I see him raise up like that. They're just about to make the last step. I can see him reach over there and say, come here! To a big thunderhead hanging back there. Oh, my. It obeyed him! I stand here and say, east wind, north, west, and south. Come here, get on this thunderhead. I'm going to drive you like horses and we're going to sit on this thunderhead this morning like a chariot. I'm going to embarrass myself. Hallelujah! I see him reach up, get a hold of the zigzag lights, crack across the sky. I'd like that just to make their last step, walking in God's provided way. And about the time they hit in there, he passed by the sea of ice, picked up a palm, and he was standing down there fanning the breeze off. Hallelujah! He's always there when man will walk God's provided way. Yes, sir. One time there's an old quack preacher, an old holiness preacher, back down a long time ago by the name of Noah. He said, you know, it's going to rain. It's going to come a storm. I hear the people go around and say, do you hear that old holy roller up there? He said, it's going to rain. Well, it never rained up on the earth. He's going to rain. How, where'd that water come from? Well, let's go get the science out and find out if there's any water up there. Why, no, there's no water up there. What's the matter? That old preacher's off in his head. But God said so.
Amen.
God said, prepare an ark, Noah, for the saving of your household, for the saving of the people. And Noah just had sense enough to do it. That's all. He come and prepared the ark. And one day I hear some of them down on the corner talking down the business corner. Some of them say, hey, what about that rain story up there? That old quack preacher talking about it's going to rain up there. Did you ever hear such a thing? And he thinks he's in God's provided way. He was. Amen. The first thing you know, there comes thunder and lightning. I see the old, big old Mammy Camel out there look up and say, Papa Camel? You hear what that was? That was thunder. That's what Noah said. Let's get to the ark. Down across the hill we went. Here come Papa Horse and Mama Horse and all the rest of the pairs right into the ark. One by one, God closed the door, set the rain. Noah's in God's provided way. Some of them got on logs that our folks do, but our day when the storms began to rain, the ark went up. Hallelujah. While they were in God's provided way. God will always bless people that are walking away. He provides. He never provided a law. He never provided this. He provided an ark. And today, my brother and sister, there is a way provided for men and women. That's through Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who died under a Calvary. Plus, we have remission of sins and can receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost as approval of God that He's accepted us into His Son, Christ Jesus. Safely secured. Hallelujah! Don't call me on your order anyhow, so you might as well get started now. Alright, I feel pretty good. Alright, you believe that? That is God's way, the only way. It ain't the Methodist way, it ain't the Baptist way, it ain't the Presbyterian, it ain't the Pentecost, it's Christ's way. Christ is God's provided way. God provided sacrifice, He's Jehovah Rapha. He's Jehovah Jireh. He's Jehovah Manasseh. When Abraham offered up Isaac, he called the place Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide Himself a sacrifice. And there it is.
Amen.
The Son of God.
Amen.
Amen. God always makes a way of escape. Yes, sir. one time there's an old preacher down there preaching by the name of Elisha. He got up there and looked out over the country and he said, I tell you, it's the awfulest I ever seen. Little old came down there and went and married a little old penny, that's Jezebel.
Amen.
And that's painting on her face, and they the only woman in the Bible that ever painted her face.
Amen.
And you know what God did to her? God fed her to the dog. Said, you believe that? Sure. Said, you believe why Brother Jonah's not in heaven, said then you had to ask. Only one place left for him, that's hell. If you reject God's way, you've got to go to hell. You have to go to hell.
Either one way or the other.
Amen. All right. I can see him down there, sitting up there, and ravens bringing something to eat. Walk back down there one of the hill one day, and God said, now the pool's dried up. I want you to go down there to a widow's house. What a place for a preacher to go. God told him to go. That was provided way. He walked down there, and she wasn't an Israelite either. No, she was. And she walked back down, and he went down the hill, and as he went down the hill, he met an old widow standing in the yard, breaking a stick. He said, go in and give me something to eat and bring me some water. She said, if the Lord lives in your soul every night, I've only got enough meal in the house to make one little cake for my son. I'm taking two sticks that I might bake this cake and he and I eat it and die. Then go fetch me a little water first and bake the cake and bring it to me. What you gonna do? There's God's provided way. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. He said, Brother Bill, my mother run away from home, my husband won't live with me. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Hallelujah! All these other things will be added. That's right. How am I going to do it, Brother Bill? Just go ahead and do it. Jesus said, follow me. That's right. Keep your eyes single. All right, the first thing you know, she goes in. She takes these two sticks and breaks them. You know how the old Indian way of breaking a stick? That was the cross, of course. And in the cross, they burn it right in the middle. That's where the fire was. Burnt that whole cake up. Brought the whole cake out, give it to the preacher. He stood there and he said, now go back and get one for yourself and your son. For thus saith the Lord, the barrel is not going to run empty, or the cruise dry until the day that God's hands rain on the earth. Hallelujah! What? Because she sought the kingdom of God first, because she walked in God's provided way. God rewarded. You believe that? Yes, sir. There was a woman one time who lost her brother. His name was Lazarus. Oh, he was a good boy. She hated to give him up. And he died. She sent for her pastor, or the evangelist, which was Jesus. She'd come out of the church and she'd give up all they had. She sent for Jesus, come pray. He just went on. Then again, he just went on. He said, I'll do nothing until the Father showed me. The Father had already showed him Lazarus was going to die. He come back a while after about 3 or 4 days. He said, Lazarus dead, and for your sake, I'm glad it wasn't there. But I'll go wake him. So then she heard Jesus was coming, so she went out to meet him. That was God's provided way. Go meet Jesus.
Amen.
That's right, always. When you got a sorrow in your home, go meet Jesus.
Amen.
Got sickness in your home, go meet Jesus.
Amen.
Got heartaches in your home, go meet Jesus. Hallelujah! You got an east in anything, go meet Jesus.
Amen.
Go meet him. He's got all the remedies. Everything there. He ain't got the remedies, he's got the cure. Amen. Then she went to meet him, and she fell down at his feet, and she read a story one time. Well, there was a woman way back in the Bible at a Shunammite. She was very mindful of a preacher by the name of Elisha. So she made a little chamber on the side of her house there, put a bed and a candle and a stool and so forth. And Elisha come by and seen all this goodness she'd done to the preacher, paid her tithes and everything, you know. So he said, go ask me what we can do. If I should speak to the king or to the chief captain, she said, I abide with my people and everything's all right. I said, all right, go ask her what can I do. And Gehazi said, she's barren, she has no children. I said, go tell her, thus saith the Lord, about this time of the year, according to life, that she'll receive a son. And she did. The kid got to be about 11 or 12 years old. One day about noontime, he's out to be with his daddy. If he got a sunstroke, he's going to harm my head, my head. He sent one of the servants in with the baby. The little boy set him on his mother's lap, at noon he died. What an appropriate place. She took him up and laid him on the preacher's bed, where the prophet had laid him. Good place to go. Laid right on the preacher's bed. She said, saddle me a mule now, and go forward, and don't stop your riding until I bid you. I like that. Go forward, and don't stop. Just keep going. That's right. The trouble is, we stop to talk to too many people. We stop for too many social parties.
We have so many so-and-so's, organized stitching parties, you know, stitching so and talk about Miss so-and-so, you know how it is. All these different things come into the church when you are to throw all that gully wash out and have an old-fashioned God-sent revival. Praise you from your vast heavens down and the Holy Ghost comes like a rushing mighty wind and fills the place of the people. What we need. She said, don't you stop. And her husband said, the man's not a Carmel. Said, this is neither new moon or Sabbath. She said, oh, well, she wanted to get to the prophet. So she went straight on. Well, Elisha looked at her and said, here comes that Shunammite. Something's wrong with her. I don't know what it is. She ran up and he said, is all well with thee and thy husband, thy child? She said, all is well. I like that. She's taking God's provided way. Said, everything's all right now. And then she began to reveal it. He told Elisha, said, go take my staff and lay it. Or told Gehazi, go take my staff and lay it on the child. But she said, I'm not going to leave you. So the prophet came back over, prayed, walked up and down the room, laid his body upon the dead child, and he come to life. The woman, Martha, knew that the Shunammite realized that God was in his prophet. And if God was in his prophet, surely God was in his son. So if she could get to Jesus, she'd have the remedy. So she runs and falls down before him. She said, Lord, if that's what he was, Lord. If thou would have been here, my brother would not die. But even now, whatever you ask God, God will do it. Oh, I like that. Even now, whatever you ask God, God will do it. That's good tonight. You say, I'm a sinner, Brother Bram. Even now, whatever you ask God, God will do it. Have mercy on me, a sinner, he'll do it. If you're sick, have mercy on me, Lord, he'll do it. Even now. You say, the doctor, give me up, but even now, Lord. I haven't walked in 5 years, but even now, Lord. I haven't heard nothing for I don't know when. Even now, Lord. I haven't spoken a word, I can't tell you when, but even now, Lord. Whatever you ask God of me, sitting at the right hand of the Father, making intercessions upon your profession. Hallelujah! Say, even now, whatever you ask God, God will do it. He straightened his little step up and said, thy brother shall rise again. Said, oh yes, Lord, in the general resurrection of the last day, he'll rise again. He said, I am the resurrection. All right. The Bible said there's no beauty to look at, a little pretty looking fellow. But he said, when he straightened himself up, there was God. He said, now your brother rise again. Said, I am the resurrection life, saith God. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? He said, yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Son of God which had come into the world. So where you lay? Here he starts to the grave. Jesus wept. A woman told me not long ago, a very good woman, a Christian scientist, who didn't believe that Jesus was had deity. She believed that he was a prophet. She believed that he was a good man. But he was wasn't a virgin born. They deny the virgin birth. Not only that, but a survey showed that 85% of the Protestant preachers of the United States claim that the virgin birth was a fake.
Amen.
Right. I can easily do that. I can easily think that from the way you live it. That's exactly the truth. Believe it was a fake. There's a greater percent that didn't believe that Jesus would visibly return again. No wonder we need a revival. Brother, listen here. You hear so much about revival today. We've never had a revival.
Amen. Amen.
I followed up another man here not long ago where he talked about a lot of this. Said he went to one city and they had 5,000 conversions. We followed right behind it, not me, a group of ministers, and took the cars and followed them back again. And in 30 days' time, they couldn't find 30 that claimed to be saved. You know what I think? I think it's conviction instead of conversion when I'm born again of the Spirit of God. What we need today is not a protracted meeting, but an old-fashioned, God-sent, Holy Ghost revival. An old-time, sky-blue, sin-killing, drug-wash religion.
Amen!
Makes you take them tar jewels back and you repent. That's right. She said, and she said, well, look here, Brother Ram, I can prove to you that he wasn't nothing but a man. I said, do it. If you can prove to me that Bible, then I'll accept it. She said, are you ready? I said, I am. She said, when he went down in St. John 11, when he went to the grave of Lazarus, he wept. I said, well, that's got to do with it. Said, well, it proved he was nothing but a man. He was crying. I said, look at your lady. He was a man, truly, but he was more than a man. He was a God-man. God was in Christ, reconciled the world to himself. Yes, sir, he came to do the will of the Father. He walked God's provided way. He never looked to the right or to the left. He done what God said to do. He walked God's provided way. And on the road to Lazarus, he wept. He was a man when he was weeping. But when he stood there to the side of a grave where a man had been dead 4 days ago, gross skin worms running in and out of his body and a stink around, when he said, come forth! A man had been dead 4 days. Stood on his feet and lived again. That was more than a man. Hallelujah! Yes, sir. He was a man crying, but he was God in the resurrection. He was a man when he come down off the mount that night, hungry, looking all around on the trees for something to eat. He was a man when he was hungry, but when he touched five biscuits and two little pieces of fish and fed 5,000 people, that was more than a man. That was God's flesh. Hallelujah. He was a man when he laid on the book that night where virtue went out of his garments till he was so weak till even a mighty sea roaring, 10,000 devils of the sea swore they had drowned him that night. When that little old boat tossed about out there like a bottle stopper on a mighty sea. Oh, he was a man when he was laying there asleep. But when they said, care thou not that we perish, he stuck his foot up on the frail old boat, said, peace, be still. And there was a calm. That was more than a man. That was my God. Right he was. Yes, indeed he is. He was a man when he was hanging on Calvary. When they give him the greatest tribute he ever did. When he said he saved others, he cannot save himself. What a wonderful tribute, a compliment they paid him. If he saved his others himself, he couldn't save others. So he had to give himself in order to save others. He was a man when he cried for mercy. When he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He died like a man. Yes! But when he rose on Easter morning, he proved he was God. So when the prophet said, living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified freely forever. Someday he's coming, oh glorious day. Hallelujah! I love him. Don't you walk in God's provided way? I did see some wise men one time going to his birth to worship him. I can see them all getting ready. They're packing up their camels. I can see Jim Jones and all the rest of them and John Doe packing up. I can see them laying these card tables packed on the side like that. And they laid everything else on. And they were going to go to worship Jesus and come to find out when he got ready to start, the old camels couldn't walk. That's just what's the matter with the church today. You pack so much world with it, it can't be. I can see him start out like that, and all of them get to the side of the mountain, and they can't even get through. Go straight is the gate, and there is the way, but few that will be able to find it. Yes, sir. I can see one old guy packing up. He's making himself right. Fell say, I'm packing up to go to heaven. Brother, I'm not packing up to go to heaven. I'm unpacking to go to heaven. Hallelujah! And rapture cut loose everything. The Bible said, let us lay aside every weight in the sin that so easily beset us, that we might run this race with patience. I see that old fellow going, I see his wife around and say, John, what's the matter, boy? Where are you going? Said, I'm going to worship the Lord. How do you know you're going? Well, I'm going. Well, you haven't even got a compass. You haven't even got your ministerial license. What in the world's the matter with you? What, do we see you? You're going to worship the Lord, yeah? Take your compass. No, I don't need it. Don't need it. How are you going to get there? I see it point up to the morning star. Then I'm going God's provided way. God provided a star. the storm is here tonight in the form of the Holy Ghost to lead you to the Christ. The new birth, the baptism of the Holy Ghost, which is God's provided way. Except a man be born of water and spirit, he won't even see the kingdom of God. Men and women, have you received it? My time's up. Oh my, I just feel like getting into it. Put my hand down in my pants pockets and preaching like an old sass rat preacher. Father! It's all right to have ice cream, but you got to have some bacon and beans to stick to your side. Got you to feed and slice you up. That's what we need. Don't you believe it?
Yes.
Truly, God has a provided way on the innocent. Have you received the Holy Ghost? Don't you believe it? Now, you good Baptist friends in life, and know that I was a Baptist, and my pastor here is a Baptist, but I want to tell you something. Acts 19 says, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe?
Amen.
Not when you believe, but since you believe.
Praise the Lord.
Yes, sir. If you haven't, it's for you tonight. God has a provided way. Brother, sister, don't try to go your own way. Don't go through fig leaves. Don't go floating on a log like you're trying to do in the antediluvian destruction. Don't put fig leaves over like Adam did. Don't try to go king never who does his way to persecute the church of God. Don't go all these other different ways, these forms and ways that we can mention many. Don't go like the Pharisees did of their religious persons that now looky here, we're in a high place, and if there be anything going on, we'll know all about it. And God stepped out there and born the child in a Bethlehem manger, took him down through the world and out the way of capital punishment, and they didn't know nothing about it.
Amen.
Right. God's provided way. Oh, I remember the woman. She spent all the money she had. Hallelujah. Doctors could do her no good. And one day she's just about to faint. She'd had an issue of blood for many, many years. And one day she heard some roaring in a boat. She looked out, and there come God's provided way. Oh, I can see her come down with a high classical Baptist. The days of miracle bag, she just crawled right between the legs. I see her come there with Brigham Young and all his wives. She just passed right on through. Why did she say it? I didn't say, Arthur. Where are you going if the physician can't do you no good? Where are you going? I see you down here with that issue. She said, I'm going God's provided way.
Amen.
What's that? You don't mean that hypocrite over there? That's where it's at. I'm going right on, and she squeezed through and around until she got to this fellow here, and he belonged to this kind of church and this and that. They all tried to push her back, but she made her way to Jesus.
Amen.
Some of them said, now wait a minute, sister. If you eat meat, you can't do it. She's going God's provided way. If you haven't taken up serpents, you can't do it. She went God's provided way. She wanted to get to Jesus. That's right. I think of David a little. Oh, hallelujah. Yes, sir. When he said there, when he talked about, he said, taste and see the Lord is good. It tastes like honey and rum. A little description I used to use, thinking about an old script we used to carry on the side here. Little sacks that they put honey in, the old shepherds did. And when the sick would get, the sheep would all get sick, they'd take off some of the honey out of the script bag and put it on a limestone rock and call the sick sheep. And let that sick sheep go licking on that rock. And when he go licking the honey off of the rock, he went and licked some of the limestone in while licking the honey. You know what happened? The sick sheep got well. Now look here, brother, I got a whole script bag full of it tonight, and I'm going to put it on the Baptist church, Methodist church, the Presbyterian church, or the Pentecostal church. I'm putting it on Christ Jesus, where it's wrong, and you sick sheep go to licking, and you're sure to get something out of it. Oh, lick on him, not your old man today, and then the real card. Lick on him. You'll give it. Don't pay attention to what your church says. Pay attention to Christ. For in him, he is the church. I see go God's provided way. He never said the Methodist was God's provided way, and he didn't say the Baptist was. Or any other church, he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, well, how do I know what it is? By one spirit, we're all baptized into one body, become members of that body. 1 Corinthians 12. That's right. Subject to God, everything he's got in his kingdom belongs to us. He just takes a whole big book full of checks and signs his name on the bottom and says, here you are, son, anything you need, go get it. Amen. Don't be afraid to fill it out. Fill it out. Hand it in and say, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You'll come to pass. Watch the other things you desire. Mark 11:24. When you pray, believe you receive it, you shall have it. Find out the text, the Lord, and he healed it. Tell her off. Say, there you are, Lord. I ask in Jesus' name for healing. Say, thank you, Lord.
Walk that on way.
Call the healing. Come down. Stop that cruel sending down that food to Elijah. There it is. Thou needs salvation for my soul. Well, you just try out faith. He said, come unto me, all you laboring and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. That's for me, Lord. If you're not checking, need salvation, hand it to me, Lord. Here it is. Thank you, Lord. Walk away with it. Need the Holy Ghost. Yes, sir. Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you're due with power from on high. As in this, the Holy Ghost come upon you, you'll be witness to me in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and the other most parts of the world. You need it? You'll have to check and set it up tonight and see what happens. Gotta get it. God's provided way. He provided you a checkbook. Wait until now. God promised it. Do you believe that? Sure. God always has a provided way. There's the Lord God in the name of Jairus one day. Oh, he kind of joined his step up with a bunch of unbelievers, like a whole lot of preachers that are joined up the same way today. Bible said, yoke yourself not amongst unbelievers. All right. The first thing you know, what? Who says that? You are. Well, the Bible says, these signs shall follow them that believe.
Amen.
In my name, they shall cast out devils, speak with new tongues, take up serpents, drag dead things, or lay hands on the sick, they shall recover.
Amen.
You have preached that in half the churches, they to kick you out the door.
Amen.
Right? That's right. Don't know God's provided way, but that's what he said. That's what Jesus said. Do you believe it?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. And then if he said so, amen. I believe it. I think it's the truth. And I'm walking his way, what he said to me. And he's confirmed it with signs and wonders following.
Amen.
That's right. So just do the same thing. Walk on his forever, whosoever will, and he come on in. Just come on. God's called you. You've got to come. So come right on in. Don't wait any longer. Take it tonight. I see this little fellow. He joined himself up. He loved Jesus, but yet he was just trying to wait. He didn't want to lose his prestige. You know, the prestige. So he said, I did. So the Lord said, look at that little fellow down there. I predestinated him to eternal life, and there he is with that bunch of unbelievers. So I picked him up, just let his daughter get sick. He said, well, I'll call in Dr. Dole. Dr. Dole looked her over. He said, cough's getting low. Charles, tell you what we better do. We better do this and that. They give her all the drugs and so forth. She went right on dying. And he said, I wonder if God's got a provided way. Oh, my. The man he criticized so much about divine healing, I heard them, and he said, yes. Charles, don't you think he's a hypocrite? No, said the Holy Spirit. He's not a hypocrite. You believe in him. I guess he is. That's the way some of these borderline preachers are. Just afraid all God takes a wishbone out of you and put a backbone in you. I asked somebody about it this morning. He said, Lord, the size of a sorrow, put plenty of knowledge in the gable into my soul, and let me fight the devil as long as I got one tooth left and I'm coming till I die. All right. Right. You say, I'm all cooled out. She popped two, so she didn't have one tooth left, and she just gummed that coon and squeal. I like that. All right. How is it? I'm too small. The preachers are turning me down. This is so bad. Listen, brother. It ain't the size of the dog in the fight. It's the size of the fight in the dog. That's what makes you better. I'm not complaining over the dog that's standing there. I do what Jesus said one day. If you got converted, I'll get along. Jesus said, I'll tell you, brother. Said there's two dogs, and he one's black and one's white. The black one wants to do wrong, the white one wants to do right. Said they always fight and quarrel. I said, which one wins? She said, depends on which one she needs the most. That's all right, too. Yes, sir. All right, brother. I'm telling you what the world needs tonight is a good old shaking. Dry said, now, wait a minute. The daughter got real sick. The only hope there was to ever get her was to go to Jesus. She made some call for Jesus. While he was on the road, I seen him coming up there, and the woman just got to heal with a blood issue. Here he goes along. He said, my daughter's laying now. I don't care what the priest says, what anybody says. Will you come lay your hands on her? I believe your God's provided way for her healing. Will you come lay your hands on her? She get well. I'll go. Here he starts going on. The first thing you know, here run a man from the house in. Jairus, don't weary the master because she's already dead. I can see his little heart jumping in my chest. I see those lovely tender eyes of Jesus roll to him and say, I say, fear not, now shall see the glory of God. He's God's provided way. There's an old man by the name a blind Bartimaeus, sat at the gates one day, begging for alms. It was getting cold weather, about October. He heard an noise coming down the street. What is that? Why, he said, that's Jesus of Nazareth. He never watched. He pulled off his robe. He never laid it down, folded up so you know he could blindly find his way back to it. He threw his robe aside. God had provided a way, and he was after it. He run down here sometimes and say, sit down, sit down. He ain't got no time to fool you. He screamed much louder, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on me. He's pressing through, have mercy on me. I know your God's provided way for my eyes. Come on, have mercy on me. Kept crying. I read the history of blind Bartimaeus one day. A little story. They said that he had been blind for years. He had a little daughter he had never seen. One night, and he used to go up there and set the street, he had a little lamb. The lambs used to lead the blind people like the dogs does today. The dogs lead the blind man. They had a lamb trained to lead the blind. And then one said one day that he had two little turtle doves, and they would do little tumbles like that to attract the tourists' attention going into Jerusalem or into the city, and they would drop coins in his cup. He was blind. So one night, his wife got real sick. So he went to the Lord and said, Lord, I haven't got nothing. I'm a poor man. I'm a blind man. I haven't got nothing to give you. But I believe you, Lord. If you just have mercy, let my poor wife live. Tomorrow I'll give you my turtle doves for sacrifice. The Lord healed his wife that night. The next day he went back to the priest, offered up the two turtle doves for sacrifice. Then he had nothing but the lamb. Not long after that, his little girl got sick. The doctors could do nothing for her. He said, Lord, I only got one thing left. And said, that's the lamb. But if you'll let my little girl, who I've never seen, if you'll only let her get well, then I'll give you my lamb for a sacrifice. Said the Lord healed his little girl. A few days after that, he started up the street. That's where I'm leading. And Caiaphas, the high priest, came out. Said, blind Bartimaeus, where goest thou? He said, I go, O high priest, to the temple. The lamb is leading me to the temple to offer the lamb for a sacrifice. Oh, he said, you can't do that. He said, yes, Bartimaeus. He said, here, I'll give you the price of a lamb. You go buy one. He said, I never promised God a lamb. I promised him this lamb.
Amen.
This lamb. He said, blind Bartimaeus, thou cannot take that lamb. That lamb is your eye. You can't see without that lamb. That lamb leads you. That's your eyes, blind Bartimaeus. You can't offer that lamb. So the old man trembled a little bit and said, oh, high priest, God will provide a lamb for blind Bartimaeus' eyes.
Amen.
God bless his heart. When he heard that coming back, God had provided a lamb. There he is. He's God's provided lamb tonight. He's the lamb provided for your eyes, your spiritual eyes. He's the lamb provided for your soul. He's the lamb provided for your escape of hell. He's the lamb provided for your glory in heaven. Won't you receive him while we pray, while we bow our heads, O Lord God, creator of heavens and earth, all of us everlasting life, give us every good gift. Send thy blessings upon this people. These poor little unprepared remarks, Lord, but I know that you have a provided way. You said as it was in the days of Noah, so will it be in the coming of the Son of Man, a preparation time, a time when a place would be prepared for those who want to escape the wrath. I pray, God, that right now, that Lamb of God that is provided for the blind man's eyes, or the woman with the blood issue to stop the blood issue, the Lamb that was provided for the dead Lazarus, God have mercy. When I think about it, that's the same lamb was provided for my blind eyes one day. When Mary told me 3 years ago I didn't have a hope of ever being well again, God provided a lamb. When you sent your angel down the other dreams mill and said, go do this, how could I do it before a great world of atheists and unbelievers? But God provided a lamb. God, my poor little church here, Lord, as I look at it, now think of many thousands of miles across the seas and poles and plains and icebergs. How I've sat there many times in the lonely room praying. Think about the times that want me to come by here and shake my hand. The old sawdust used to lay on the floor. The wind is shaking when the wind blows. I think of bringing my own guiding wife and laying her down here at the foot of the cross, preaching her funeral. Remember seeing my little baby Lord lay on her arm. I remember poor little Billy Paul that you filled with the Holy Ghost a few hours ago, coming down to her grave there that morning to put an Easter fire on it and started crying. I put my arm around the little daughter and said, God has provided a lamb, a sin offering. Someday in this little grave will open, mommy will come out and so will her sister. God has a provided lamb. Some of these days, God put my last sermons preached. I lay down in the room and I feel the pulse coming up my sleeve. The cold, dead tide is floating into my room as the windows open, the curtains blowing. Shut off the light bulb then, Lord. I'll sit the light bulb. I'll sit the sheep. Sit the sword down in the sheath of eternity. I'll walk down to the valley of shadow of death.